The last survivor of a long dead race stood before the killer of his kind, one of a legion unlike any other. The cavern began caving on them as their blood began to boil, their heart pumping like never before, and their eyes began to twitch as he painfully kept them open. The fireplace continued to crackle as wind began swirling through the open door, screams and laughter captured within it. A stone angel stood before him, a lone assassin, ready to pounce as soon as the survivor blinked. He'd seen angels such as this before. The massacre was unlike any other, and yet they were merciful. They blessed their victims with a long life before attacking again. There was no need for them to do that. No reasoning behind the chaos that the survivor had witnessed. Once an angel tries to send you back in time twice, you turn to stone and you crumble. You feel every second of it as you become part of the planet you stand upon. As nothing more than ash, dust that now sways in the wind. The survivor had no choice but to breathe in his relatives, his ancestors from long ago, and the people he once loved. His fury towards this angel was unfathomable. How can something so graceful, so angelic in appearance, be so deadly? This angel looked somewhat different than the ones he had seen last time. While their last encounter was swift, the survivor knew an angel when he saw one. This angel had a long coat and appeared to be wearing trousers that were held up by braces, a shirt with stripes on it, and it appeared more human in shape compared to the other angels. The angel looked back at the survivor, bearing her now sharp teeth. The doctor was shouting within her mind towards the survivor in an attempt to get him to move, but he couldn't hear her. All the survivor had on his mind was trying to keep his eyes fixated on the angel without closing them. One blink, that's all it takes. He knew that from experience. He knew that his chances of survival were very low as soon as the angel entered the room, but he had to try. Little did he know that this angel is the very namesake of the appearance they have been designated. A weeping angel. A deafening silence made the room feel all the more claustrophobic. Only one door stood between the survivor and their freedom. Pity that the guard in front of it would silence him before he would even get the chance to escape. He utilized his peripheral vision as much as he could to understand his surroundings. As far as he knew, there were no means of escape bar the door. His next questions were how he could get past the angel and through the door without blinking. But most importantly, how could he do so without turning around? The doorway was rather small, and the surroundings were only slightly bigger. The cabin was a remnant of his people's ingenuity, but after so long it was decrepit and moldy. Perhaps he could break through the wall behind him, the survivor thought. But a part of him didn't want to break his father's legacy. The only remainders he had left of his father was the very room he now stood in. Ironically, the living room. All of his descendants and ancestors are said to have died in this very spot. This very room is where or more when the curse of his family tree originated. His ancestors looked up towards the angels as deities prior to their genocide. Gods amongst men who took the form of stone angels as a comfort. They'd set up and manipulated an entire religion based around them as a way of farming the natives. Such ingenuity stood out to Division, which is one of the main reasons Tekteun employs them as operatives. The survivor had lived a long life after being sent back in time initially. He had had a family before the angels took them from him. Being sent back in time is one thing, but losing his entire family broke the survivor. Learning about his daughter's family and her life similar to his before crying at her deathbed. Learning about his grandson's life before doing the very same thing again and again and again until his family stopped having children. Living their lives in reverse order, destined to never meet their descendants. The legends deemed the lonely assassins as merciful, but the survivor knew more than anyone that what they offered wasn't mercy. It was nothing but pain. Thinking about his family made him tear up, but his bloodshot eyes continued to look at the angel. He had been through enough pain to learn how to endure, to adapt to agonizing situations, and to keep going. The walls felt as if they were closing in on the man as he could feel the angel's eyes piercing his soul. Deep down, he knew that these were his final moments, destined to die here, as were his family. These moments are said to give people a profound perspective on their lives. A trip down memory lane, but all he could think about was survival, an instinct that he and the angel shared. The survivor's eyes began to cloud, the room distorting and contorting around him as the angel began to grow in size. It looked as if it were fragmented, its very shape verging on itself as each atom dispersed. His mind was playing tricks on him, urging him to blink, to give in to death. Its angelic appearance was no more, and it was as if he was looking at the monster within. It was as if the angel was calling out to him. He could see a woman weeping within a dark and empty void. She wore an outfit similar to that of the angel. It was as if the angel was revealing the truth to him, but all he saw was deception, visions that were meaningless to him. She looked up towards him, and her voice was cancelled out by the other angels laughing at both him and her. He couldn't read her lips as her cries grew more and more distorted. Surrounded by darkness, the doctor sympathized with the survivor in the room, and although she couldn't share said sympathy, there was a level of understanding on her part. Even if it was one-sided, she knew what it means to be the last of a species. She didn't want to be the reasoning behind this species going extinct. Was this what Tecteun wanted her to do? Are these the orders that her and her fellow lonely assassins have been given? What did this species do to stand in the way of division? Or is Tecteun trying to prove some sort of messed up point? The doctor often asked herself questions to keep herself busy, to keep in control. But what use are questions when there is no way to find the answers? That was paradoxically another question for the doctor to add to the pile. The cacophony of howls from other angels often blocked out everything else, often leading to her venturing into the darkest depths of her mind and hiding from them. But they would always catch up to her eventually. The torment was enough to drive anyone insane, but the doctor knew that she had to stay strong. For if she didn't, the lonely assassin within her soul would take over. She would become nothing more than an angel. An angel with her intelligence would make the perfect operative for division, a trepidation that began troubling her as soon as she was recalled. She could see the survivor through the eyes of her stone husk. She wondered if he would try to run if she could communicate with him. She wondered that even if he understood why she was an angel, that his anger at the angels would cloud his judgment. Perhaps he only wants to survive out of instinct. The doctor knew that these thoughts were the angel speaking to her, tempting her by acting as if killing this man would be merciful. But deep down, the doctor recognizes the man's agony. The survivor's eyes grew more and more bloodshot as time went on. His surroundings were still distorted, and the illusion still tormented him. But as long as he knew where the angel was, and the door, the more chance he could survive. That is, if he could find the strength to move, he thought to himself. But with that, he froze. It's as if time stopped and his eyelids began to lower. He pushed and he pushed, even letting out a scream. But it wasn't long before he found himself blinking. It was in that split second that he pictured the birth of his daughter. It wasn't long after his civilization was almost extinct. He had found love within a shelter, and in turn had a chance to leave a legacy behind, a legacy that outlived him in the wrong time. It was the happiest day of his life. He looked into his wife's eyes and looked down at their beautiful child. The child would become an orphan in another time as their planet became an orphan planet. He opened his eyes to see the angel had moved closer to him, its arms pointing outwards, blocking his means of moving towards the door. The survivor took this as the angel playing with his prey. But in truth, it was the doctor trying her hardest to keep the angel at bay, to stop herself from feasting on the remainder of this man's life. The survivor began to think about the afterlife, the promise that he would reunite with his family once again, and he continued to lock eyes with the angel. The angel's face being mere inches away from him terrified him, but even so, he found the strength within to keep fighting, to continue playing the game bestowed upon him. Not that he had much of a choice. Then again, neither did the doctor. He could almost feel the stone nearing his skin, the frigid, unforgiving hands ready to kill, ready to destroy the last remnant of his civilization, him. The foreboding nature gave him goosebumps. The hairs on the back of his neck raised and his legs began to numb. It felt as if he was already turning to stone, and yet he knew that fate was awaiting him. He wanted to run, he wanted to fight, but in reality, his body chose to freeze, condemning him to death. The doctor tried to hold herself back, but the hunger was too much. The insatiable, sadistic urge to take this person's life defied her moral compass. She could feel her very soul darkening as she could no longer hold herself back. All it would take was one more blink, and the survivor would be no more. Her mind was plagued by thoughts of her friends, her fam. She often thought about them in these moments as her means of prevention. Her faith and love for them gave her the strength to fight the curse, especially while thinking about Yaz. She'd only just met Dan, and the others had been and gone, but there was something more when it came to Yaz. A feeling she was curious about, but didn't truly understand. Perhaps she won't have the chance to, she thought. It was in that moment of weakness that the doctor was temporarily no more. Her mind had retreated from the stone angel it was locked within, forced to watch as there was nothing to stop the hunger from taking over. The angel began to control the lights within the room, and the survivor knew their time was up. He could hear his daughter's voice through the angel, and although he knew it was the angel toying with him, it was comforting. Perhaps history was right, he thought. Perhaps they are merciful. It was then that the survivor fell towards the ground. He closed his eyes in acceptance, and in that moment, he could briefly feel the cold touch of the angel. His skin began to crumble, turning to stone before falling apart. He opened his eyes again to look at the angel one last time, but it had vanished. He shut his eyes once again, picturing his family as the process unfolded. His final thought was that he would be with them once again, that he would reunite with his family, and even though they are older than him, it won't deter his love for them. But in this plane of existence, he was now nothing more than dust in the wind.